Good morning.
Morning.
Once again, it is a pleasure and it is an honor to see so many here willing to worship our God who is so gracious, loving, and kind to each of us. And as you know, for the most part, we've been going through and examining the book of Romans as Paul writes this magnificent letter to the church there in Rome with an expectation and a desire to see them one day. Though not under the circumstances we know he eventually does, which of course is in prison. And Paul, having wrote this great letter, we see a number of things that are of necessity. If you have your Bibles, go ahead and turn to Romans chapter 13. We'll be looking today at verses 8 through 10. But as always, because chapter 12 through chapter 15, verse 13 or so, is based on the application of the doctrine that is given in the first 11 chapters, it's good to be reminded of what has led up to Paul in our text this morning. As I said, in the first 11 chapters, of course, Paul dealt with doctrinal matters. He dealt with such matters as faith and justification from it. He dealt with matters of division in a large portion because you had such a great divide there in the church between those who were Gentile and had become children of God and those who had been Jews and had become children of God. As we mentioned, starting there in the 12th chapter, there was a shift from those doctrinal matters to the application of those matters in which had been discussed, had been talked about, had been and were expected to be studied. And so everything from chapter 12 through chapter 15, as we see in this application process, has to refer back to and does refer back to the teachings that Paul was trying to get across to the brethren there in Rome. We started by noticing that how the brethren were supposed to, having been justified by faith, were having supposed to have offered themselves as a living sacrifice, Romans chapter 12, 1 through 3. Right after being justified by faith, having their sins washed away, becoming children of God. This sacrifice, which was supposed to take place, as I mentioned, right after justification, or salvation as it's otherwise known, would help them have the right attitude in proving what is the will of God. As we see, we then notice that if one is able to prove what was the will of God and what is the will of God, then they would also be able to think soberly, Romans chapter 12, verse 4 through 8. This ability to think logically, think soberly, one translation says think sensibly, would help them as they individually were given measures of faith to help unify the congregation. Remember, the division that had been so obvious and so apparent. And so as Paul talks about the way in which they bring about unity in the congregation, he talks about how each individual member is vital to the whole. This is one of the reasons, of course, attendance is so necessary, isn't it? Hebrews 10:25. Because of what verse 24 says. It's the avenue by which when we gather together, we gain encouragement from each other. Verse 25, as the day draws near, now in their case, 87, even in our case, the second coming of Christ and judgment day. Now, from that, from talking about the collective and how to be united collectively and purely, Paul then turns his attention in the rest of the chapter. He turns his attention on how to make that collective whole group better individually. And this was done, we saw, by the fruit of genuine love. If each of them held and produced the fruit of genuine love, then it would help them in their measure of faith collectively as a congregation and remove any barriers between them, remove the baggage that's between them, and help them grow together. Paul wanted the church at Rome to understand this relationship. He then takes a shift, doesn't he? When we think about the time frame by which the book of Romans is written, it's during the Emperor Nero's reign of the Roman Empire. Nero, who famously burned down most of Rome and then blamed it on the Christians to spur persecution of them. The same emperor who would light up his parties in the evening with the bodies of those who were followers of Christ. And in Romans chapter 13, and still sticking with this idea of how to stay unified and help each other, Paul says, listen, as people under this government understand that there has to be a relationship still between church and state, between the government you're under and yourself. There's a relationship there, Romans 13, 1 through 7. There's an expectation of God's children to understand that the government has been set up by God for his purpose. Now, that does not mean that every government does what God wants, but it does mean that he sets up every government to use for his purpose. And there are certain expectations, as we see there in verse 7, there are certain oaths, loans, if you will, as we'll see today, that we are expected to pay, whether it is physically our taxes, things of this nature, or spiritually, respect and honor that is due them, we have to remember that God has established the governments, has set them in place for his will. Now, they could gather behind that, couldn't they, as a whole? As a group of people encouraged to come together, be united even in this effort. Which brings us to our text today, Romans chapter 13, verses 8 through 10, where Paul really pulls all of this, really from chapter 12, 1 all the way through here, pulls all of this together in what he's trying to get across on this idea of unity. He ends our previous section, as we talked about, paying to all what is owed them. Whether it's taxes to taxes, respect to respect, pay all that is owed to them. And in our section today, verse 8, he picks up there using that to demonstrate how to fulfill law. So with that in mind, let's go ahead and read our text this morning. Romans chapter 13, let's read verses 8 through 10. Paul says there, owe no one anything except to love each other, for the one who loves another has fulfilled law. The commandments, you shall not commit adultery, you shall not murder, you shall not steal, you shall not covet, and any other commandment are summed up in this word. You shall love your neighbor as yourself. Love does no wrong to a neighbor, therefore love is the fulfilling of law. When we read that and we look at that, we see a powerful illustration being demonstrated by Paul, inspired by God, to the people. And that is the illustration, the expectation that they were to love their neighbors. Now, the idea of loving one's neighbor is found throughout the scriptures, isn't it? It is either specifically stated or implied throughout time, whether it be all the way from Genesis 4, where God implies that Cain should have been looking after his brother Abel, not murdering him. Whether it goes through the commandments, where we see in the Ten Commandments, where they are to love their neighbor as themselves. And whether we go to the New Testament, in fact, that exact phrase, love your neighbor as yourself, is found 8 times in the Bible. Surprisingly, only once in the Old Testament. Of course, where it's listed there as one of the Ten Commandments in Leviticus, but it's found 7 other times there in the New Testament. So with that in mind, let's go ahead and look at our first point. If you have your handout, notice the first point, owe no one anything. It is sometimes amazing how often people can take parts of verses or a verse as a whole, in other words, just that whole verse, and in many ways ignore the rest of Scripture surrounding the same topic. You and I know we've all heard this for years and seen this for years. Preachers have even been guilty of this for years, using, for example, Matthew 18, where two or three are gathered, there in my name, I will be there also, right? People say, well, listen, as we come to worship, Jesus there. Well, it's taken out of context. It's talking about church discipline, where two or three are gathered to discipline, to try to get one, Galatians chapter 6, 1 and 2, to repent and to bear that burden with them, to get them to come back. Then Christ is there. It's not talking about worship at all. So sometimes people get this idea, they look at things, they take pieces of Scripture, and as we've mentioned before, it's easy to do, isn't it? In Matthew chapter 24, I told you the probably most egregious point, where Jesus is talking about, you know, the destruction of Jerusalem in AD 70, and there he says, don't be on the housetop, come down. And I mentioned about the denominational preacher there in the 1920s who was preaching against the top knot hairdo, remember? And he used that as proof text where he took out just that part, said, top knot, come down. So people for years have been doing this, haven't they? This is one of those areas, if we're not careful, one of those verses that some have abused or misused in trying to suggest something that the Scriptures has never taught. So let's look again at verse 8 and examine it. Owe no one anything except to love each other. Let's go ahead and stop there. If this was all God's Word had to say about lending and borrowing, if you will, it still would not make sense to use this as a proof text to never take a loan, because this verse is used as that to try to say it's wrong to, for example, get a loan for a home or a loan for a car. It's wrong to have a credit card or anything like that. People have used this verse for years to suggest that it would be a sin to do so. Now, don't get me wrong, we must be good stewards. That's not the question. We must be good stewards of what we have because it's been given to us by God. It is His and not ours. But there's nothing in this verse to say that it is a sin to loan if we look at the totality of Scriptures and the context for which it is being said. Now, to demonstrate this, I want to first see what the Bible says on the topic. The topic of loans. And to do that, I want to begin by looking at the Old Testament. Now, I know we're not under that law anymore, Colossians 2 and 14, Romans chapter 7, 1 through 4. However, Romans 15 and verse 4 makes it clear that those things that were written in the past were written there for our learning, to see how God dealt with things and to see if there is the application found there in the New Testament. And so as we look at that, let's go ahead, or we think about that, let's look at what is said there in Exodus 22, verse 25. Here God writes, if you lend money to any of my people, with you who is poor, you shall not be like a money lender to him, and you shall not extract interest from him. Now notice what is under consideration here. It's not a condemnation of loaning money. It's a condemnation of putting interest or tacking interest onto it, especially to the poor. We see the same basic concept in Leviticus 25, 36 and 37. Take no interest from him or profit, but fear your God, that your brother may live beside you. You shall not lend him your money at interest, nor give him your food for profit. Notice it doesn't say don't give him food or don't loan him money. Don't help your brother out in such and a loan, but don't do so to gain profit. In other words, tack interest onto it so that you can gain and make money by lending it. We're not one, as we saw there in Exodus, you're not one of those money lenders, those banks, if you will, with interest. Jesus, in Luke chapter 6, verse 35, would say it like this. But love your enemies and do good and lend. Expect nothing in return, and your reward will be great. And you will be sons of the Most High, for He is kind to the ungrateful and the evil. Here Jesus clearly says we can lend to others, including brethren, but do not expect it in return. Now, The idea isn't don't get your money back in any form or fashion. In fact, because the word lend here literally means to give to someone, to lend them or to let borrow them borrow it with a return in mind. But what Jesus is saying is, as brethren, if someone needs a loan and we lend them that money, there's nothing wrong with lending them that money, but we need to be patient, not harsh and demanding, and if it be the case, we need to be willing not to take anything back. Maybe a brother or sister comes into a hard, difficult time, and maybe they're not able to. Maybe they die. We don't expect it from the wife or the kids or whoever it is. That's the idea really under consideration here. It's not saying in any form or fashion not to lend. In fact, Jesus is saying the opposite. The point is, there's nothing wrong with borrowing money, as some might suggest. So what exactly, having learned that, having looked at that, so what exactly does Paul mean there in verse 8? Owe no one anything. To answer that, we need to first go back one verse, and that's to verse 7. As I mentioned earlier, this is a connected verse, verse 8 to verse 7. Pay to all what is owed to them. Taxes to whom taxes are owed, revenue to whom revenue is owed, respect to whom respect is owed, honor to whom honor is owed. William Greathouse rightly concluded really what verse 8 is dealing with when he shows the connection here in verse 7 when he said this: do not constitute a state of owing any of the obligations referred to in verse 7, but fulfill them and discharge them. In other words, when we look at owe no one anything, it is connected to verse 7, which means don't have outstanding debts. Don't keep ignoring what you owe, rather fulfill what you owe. Hold to your word. Do what you're supposed to do. If it's to pay taxes, hold to your word, a part of that government, to pay your taxes. If you've loaned money, hold to your word to pay back what you've loaned. If you owe somebody respect because they deserve respect, such as elders deserve double honor and our great respect, then give them that respect. Don't hold it back. Don't be like the one man who said to the preacher who was needing a raise, well, I'm going to give you a 10-cent raise because I want to keep you humble. Don't hold back what is owed. Don't hold back, whether it's physical loans or spiritual loans, we are, in verse 8 here, to fulfill them and discharge them, as Greathouse stated. Now, there is a reason for that. There's a very good reason for that, Paul tells us. And the reason for that is because as ones that have been justified by faith, Romans chapter 4, and having given themselves over as a living sacrifice, 12:1-3, these ones will fulfill their role, their loans, for this reason, because it fulfills law. When one fulfills his obligations, Paul says, he in turn fulfills the law of loving one's neighbor. Let's examine the scriptures again in verses 8 and 9. Owe no one anything except to love each other. Notice, for the one who loves another has fulfilled the law. For the commandments, you shall not commit adultery, you shall not murder, you shall not steal, you shall not covet, and any other commandment are summed up in these words: you shall love your neighbor as yourself. The question we need to ask ourselves here is, what law is Paul dealing with? That's been one of the most vital questions throughout this study, hasn't it? Because without that understanding, there can be all sorts of mistakes made in context. As we've been noticing all the way up to this point, every time it mentions the word or the phrase "the law," it's talking about the law of Moses. And it's using a connection to the baggage that the Jews who had obeyed the gospel had brought in. But here we see something different. There's a shift that's worth noting. The definite article "the" before "law," as seen here, is not in the original text, like it's found everywhere else previous to this point in dealing with the law of Moses. We don't see, or it's not put in there. Paul did not place the word "the" in front of law. It should read more like this, notice. Owe no one anything except to love each other, for the one who loves another has fulfilled law. Love does no wrong to a neighbor, therefore love is the fulfillment of law. Now, why would Paul shift from having that definite article there? Why would there be a change? Why does that necessitate anything? Well, there's a specific reason for that. Because Paul is not now dealing with the law of Moses. He's dealing with a specific part of the law. Love your neighbor as yourself. Now, in our context, or in our text here, as I said, he's not dealing with all law, just specific law. That which is in connection with each other. Now, this is seen in verse 9, isn't it? In verse 10. For the commandments, you shall not commit adultery, notice, against someone else. You shall not murder against someone else. You shall not steal against someone else. You shall not covet against someone else. And any other commandment are summed up in this word, you shall love your neighbor as yourself. Notice, love does no wrong or ill, depending on your translation, to a neighbor. Paul here, in writing to the brethren, remember, who are divided. Paul, in writing to the brethren about their division, he says, listen, how do you unite? Well, he begins by talking, chapter 12, about taking the measure of faith each has and coming together to make each other whole. No one is completely whole outside of Christ. We all need each other to be whole in Christ as a family to God. To make a congregation what it ought to be, scripturally sound and where it needs to be, everybody has to work together for that. How do they unite? By having common goals, unity, working and striving on their own selves to help each other as well. So what law is under consideration here? Is it the law of Moses? I mean, we see several of the Ten Commandments here. Is Paul dealing with the law of Moses here? The answer, of course, is no. Paul is not dealing with the old law or the law of Moses. No, he's dealing with the new commandment of the New Testament. Remember, Jesus would say it to his disciples like this: a new commandment I give to you, that you love one another. Just as I have loved you, you also are to love one another. John would later write and demonstrate that this new commandment wasn't actually a new commandment, but rather the old commandment brought into the New Testament, into the New Covenant. In 1 John chapter 2, verse 7 and 8, he writes, Beloved, I am writing you no new commandment, but an old commandment that you had from the beginning. The old commandment is the word that you have heard. At the same time, it is a new commandment that I am writing to you, which is true in him and in you, because the darkness is passing away. Notice, and the true light is already shining. If you continue on there, you see he's talking about loving your neighbor as yourself, loving others, putting others first, not hating your brethren or your brothers, but loving them. There were no commandments mentioned in Romans 13 and verse 9, as we said, that are not also commandments in the New Testament. Though he's using, quoting from the Ten Commandments, he's applying them to new. And we see that these in particular are found in other places as well. Adulterers, we see that talked about, not to do it, in 1 Corinthians chapter 6 and verse 9. Murderers, 1 Peter chapter 4, verse 15. Stealers or thieves, 1 Corinthians 6 and verse 10. Covetousness, Colossians 3, verse 5. We could go on and on that. The reality is, Paul is addressing to our brethren there in Rome the importance of having each other's spiritual back. Remember the context once again. The context isn't Jew versus Gentile anymore. That's what Paul's trying to get across. That's what he's doctrinally proved through the first 11 chapters. There's no division between Gentile and Jew because all are one. Galatians chapter 3 and verse 28, all are one in Christ Jesus. There's no Jew nor Gentile, no male, no free, no slave, no master. There's none of that. In Christ, we're one. It is brother and sister helping brother and sister. In other words, what Paul was trying to get across, as we see there in Romans 13 and verse 10, I like how the Lexham Bible English translates it. Love does not commit evil against a neighbor. You see, when we look at this and we examine this, Paul, in trying to help the brethren there in Rome, those whom he loved, he saw or heard of the division that was there. In the destruction that division always causes. And Paul is trying with all his might here, inspired by God, to help them realize the dangers. It's not consistent with Scripture, verse chapter 1 through 11. And when one really gets into the church and its importance and its how it's knit together, we see that it doesn't make any proper application at all to be divided. Brothers and sisters, we have been so truly blessed, haven't we? By our God, and how foolish it would be, and how foolish it is when we see brethren committing evil against each other. I'm thankful for this congregation and its love and care and concern for one another. And I pray that we always hold true to that. That we always live up to that. Let this congregation always continue to seek each other's spiritual best interests by continually committing themselves to loving each other. To love your neighbor to your left, to your right, in front of you, and behind you. As I mentioned, 8 times that phrase, love your neighbor as yourself, is found once in the Old Testament. 7 times. In the new. It is a part of how we fulfill law to each other by loving each other. And let it be said of each of us that we love each other with all the love that God has shown us. Maybe it is the case this morning. Maybe there's someone here who maybe you felt that you haven't been loved by the brotherhood as you should, or maybe there's someone here who feels you haven't been loved. I'm not aware of this, but we don't know the innards of every single one or the thoughts of all people. If either of these are the case, let us know that we may help. That we may correct it if it's an unloving attitude, and that we may change it if it's one who feels they've been non-loved. If either of these is the case this morning, as I look across, let us help. Don't go out those doors without letting your family help you. Be a part of that and bear that burden with you in correcting it. If it is the case that someone needs the prayers of this congregation this morning, let us know now by coming forward as we stand and as we sing.